In a world of distributed systems, failure is inevitable. The system might be just a browser and a backend server, or it might be a convoluted microservices mesh because your CTO read the wrong blog post on the wrong website. Either way, every system has components and connections between components that break eventually. So you see, the difference between a robust system that lets you sleep at night and a system that everybody mocks on social media is how you deal with failure. And fortunately, most of failures are temporary. A database restart that killed old connections, a network hiccup or a router reboot, or a not exactly zero downtime deployment, or a freaking cosmic ray. And also fortunately, the big brains of the past have already figured out what to do. If at first you don't succeed, try again. However, the lesser known proverb is if you indiscriminately try again, you can take down whole systems. Your systems. Hello Internet, I'm Hinek, a software and infrastructure engineer at a hosting company in Berlin, Germany, which is why my English sounds so funny. Like you, I interact with flaky systems every single day, whether it's my flaky systems or my coworkers' flaky systems or third-party flaky systems with an ocean or two between us. So let me show you how I use Reprise such that monitoring doesn't scream at me all day and all night, but also without getting banned from third-party APIs we might need to do our business or melting our own infrastructure with overload that we definitely need to do our business. Finally, I'll show you my own little retry package for Python, and I hope at that point you'll understand why I had to build it and will be eager to run over to PyPI immediately. But let's not get ahead of ourselves and talk about retries in general first, because the topic has a lot more going on than one might think. At certain scale and under real-world conditions that we all live under, regardless of your level of denial, every system is flaky. And the more components it takes to do its job, aka how complex it is, the more things and the more connections between things can fail, which makes it flakier. And there's even a term for inevitable failure due to complexity, and it's normal accidents. A term that has been coined by Charles Perrow in the wake of the Three Mile Isle incident. Yeah, the Three Mile Isle nuke plant you read about in the news because Microsoft somehow needs it to power its chatbots. And of course, the more you use something, the more likely you'll get failure because, as they say, rare things become common at scale. So if you don't design your systems for reliability, you won't get a robust system, period. And because failure is inevitable, a system that is not built for failure will make you do a lot of manual work to keep things working instead of building cool new stuff. And one of the key tools to achieve that is to just try again when something fails. But what is going to happen if, say, a database crashes and all services that rely on it directly or indirectly fail at the same time and retry immediately again, coming in hot like a thundering herd? They take it down again. It's like trying to get out of the pool and getting pushed back in the moment you think you made it out. So yeah, big picture, the danger is that you might run a distributed denial of service attack against yourself. So what's a stressed out programmer to do? You wait a little until you try again. And this is called a back-off. How long should this back-off be? Are you ready to be senior software engineered? It depends. There's a lot of reasons for failure, so there's many back-offs that make sense. If there was just some hiccup, 100 milliseconds is great. If a database was restarted, a few seconds should do it until it's ready again. If a hardware system is rebooted, it's probably gonna take minutes. And if an excavator ripped through some network cables, Cthulhu knows where, we are talking about at least hours. And I'm saying that as someone who almost got stranded at Munich Airport after this exact thing happened to Lufthansa. And of course, you don't know which of those reasons is at play. So you need to cater to all of them by starting with a short back-off and then exponentially increase every failed retry. Ah yeah, remember exponential? But it also means that you have to stop trying eventually, because not everything recovers within a time frame that makes sense for your operation. And some things will never recover because maybe a URL wasn't actually cool and changed, or an authentication token expired, and hammering the API with the same wrong token is rather inadvisable if you'd like to keep using the API in the future. Forgetting to use timeouts on everything remote is the kissing cousin of unbounded retries. It can literally take down whole companies once blocking calls start cascading until everything ends up in a standstill. But it's a topic for another video. As far as retries go, we've now got an exponential back-off, and we stop when it makes sense for your context. But if all clients have the same back off, they still retry at the same time, so they still take the target down, just a little bit later. Which brings us to the final piece of a well-behaved retry. We add a random amount of time to each back off to spread out the retries. This is called a jitter. Now, this was the simple part and the focus of this video, because it looks at retries in isolation. There are clear rules that you have to know and mechanically apply. And please do. It will save you so many headaches in the future. But the more complicated part is applying these patterns in complex distributed systems, where one system talking to another system has no clue how many other upstream and downstream systems are involved in a request. So just imagine a client that talks to a server and retries three times, but the server talks to another server and also retries three times. So we've already got 9 requests hitting the downstream server, and imagine one more server. And you're a 3x3x3 request, which according to my public school education equals to 27 requests to the lowest server for technically 1 intended request by the user at the top. So this is called an exponential retry explosion. And there's essentially 2 solutions. One simple one is where you retry only at the edges. So only the first client is allowed to retry. But in sufficiently complex systems, it's unclear where the edge is. No server has complete knowledge of the topology around itself. And it shouldn't. That's where more complex concepts like retry budgets come into play, but that's a video series by itself. So let's get back to the grassroots, and now that we have all pieces together, let's get our hands dirty and talk practice. At the example of Python code, and there is a wonderful Python package called Tenacity that is a fork of an older package called Retrying, and you use it like this. However, by default, this code will do everything wrong I've just explained to you. It's unbounded, so it will retry until the heat end of the universe or your system, whichever comes first, and has neither a backoff nor a jitter. So DDoS season is on, and in this worst case, it can cause cascading failures. It will also retry on any error. So if you've got some typo in your code that causes an attribute error, it will result in a barrage against some or all of your APIs and databases, although they're working perfectly fine until you started stressing them because you can't type, that is. But I've already said Tenacity is wonderful, and it truly is, because it has all the knobs you need to get really great retries. Beautiful and composable knobs, no less. Seeing flexible and elegant APIs like this instead of some weird template subclassing nonsense warms my heart. But you have to carry this beauty around with you, which leads to the reality that everybody who knew about the dangers of retries were copy-pasting the same predefined decorators from project to project to project. I was one of those people until I got really sick of it. And when I get sick of something, I usually start new projects to my own detriment. In this case, the muses kissed me and I came up with the ingenious name of Stamina. It's not a re-implementation of retry logic or even a fork of Tenacity. It's a wrapper around Tenacity. All the complex but battle-tested code is still within Tenacity, but Stamina puts a nicer and safer facade in front of it. Conceptually, it's a higher-level abstraction layer that puts quality of life and safe defaults before flexibility. So it doesn't think in general hooks, but in instrumentation APIs. Or it comes with dedicated testing helpers that allow you to test your retries in a reasonable way without wasting time on backoffs and jitters. The key point of Stamina is that now you can just slap a decorator on a function or a method, async or not, and tell it what to retry on, and nothing bad happens. Your type hints stay in place, and your systems don't get exposed to unbounded barrages of retries. So the first obvious difference is that Stamina forces you to decide what exceptions to retry on. And seeing a bare exception written out like that is a telltale sign that something isn't quite best practice. If it's just implied by the defaults of a function, one has to know that it does the wrong thing by default, adding mental burden when trying to reason about the behavior of code. I'm a simple-minded man. I just like looking at things and knowing what's happening without knowing things. For finer grained control, you can even pass it a callable that gets past the raised exception that then decides whether to retry on that particular error. And this is super useful, for example, with HTTPX, which I love, but it has only one base exception for everything. And while you should retry on a 500 error, Retrying on errors in a 400 range, especially 401 and 403, is probably gonna get you banned rather sooner than later. Then, of course, you get an exponential backoff, starting at 100 milliseconds with a jitter between 0 and 1 seconds, and a cap at 5 seconds per backoff. So all your backoffs are between exactly 100 milliseconds and 5 seconds. And it's also polite enough to give up after 45 seconds or 10 retries, whichever comes first. And these parameters should be fine for most applications. But of course, you can tune all numbers to your liking, as long as it's exponential and has an upper bound. Now, this simple decorator can already ensure that you don't get paged because someone upgraded a load balancer. But stamina doesn't stop there, because sometimes you just want to retry a block of code and not wrap it in a function. Maybe because you want to interact with the retry logic, or maybe because it's ugly. So what do we need if we want to do something repeatedly? We need a loop. But a loop can't catch exceptions. So you additionally need a context manager that can catch exceptions, but can't loop. So this pattern is really clever, and credit where credit is due, I learned about it from Tenacity. And the attempt object also gives you basic introspection into your retries, so it gives you a lot of freedom to deal with retries in a very explicit way. Sometimes you do want to retry a whole function, but you just can't slap a decorator on it, because maybe it's coming from a different package that you don't control, or maybe it's a lower level function that has no business in retrying itself. Of course, stamina.retry is just a regular decorator, so you could pre-create it and apply it on the fly. But it's a bit ugly and forces you to bake in the exception type along with the retry parameters into one retry object. So stamina comes with a retrying caller and an async retrying caller that you instantiate with the retry parameters you want except for the exception it's supposed to retry on. And then you can call any callable function or method with it, taking the error as the first positional argument. Now, if you really want to pre-bind the error type to a retry too, you can do that using the on method on the retrying caller objects. So as I hope you can see, stamina is about quality of life, and I try to make common workflows straightforward with ergonomic and natural APIs. And in addition to that, it comes with two more features that I always needed and that tend to be an afterthought in other packages. The first one being testing helpers. Those who know me or have been following this channel for a while will know that I care a lot about automated testing, because I don't trust myself to write correct code, and if I did by accident, I don't trust myself to not break it in the future. So of course, testing is a first-class concept in Stamina, because jittered backoffs and fast tests don't quite mesh. So firstly, you can just deactivate retries altogether by setting stamina set active false, and that's fine for like 99% of cases. Except when you're using the iterator-based approach and want to do something before retrying again. And in this case, it would be nice to have exactly one retry with no backoff to exercise the code path. And that's where Stamina's testing mode comes in. It caps the number of retries and disables backoffs. And I believe this should cover all your testing needs. If not, please, please, please open a discussion on GitHub. Testing is very close to my heart. I will try to do my best to accommodate you too. And another thing that is very close to my heart is knowing what the hell is going on in my systems. And that's why Stamina also comes with pre-configured instrumentation. Firstly, of course, you want to know that something went wrong, even if it worked out eventually. Because otherwise, regular retries look like weird performance regressions. Things just suddenly take longer, but you don't know why. Therefore, Stamina comes with built-in support for the best Python logging package struct log with the best logo, thanks to Linroot, and falls back to the worst logging package, which is the standard library. I'm allowed to say this, the pain standard library integration in struct log has brought me over the years and is still bringing to me shall be my absolution. But in production, this is not enough. I don't want to stare at Kibana all day. So additionally, if Stamina can import the official Prometheus Python client, it will count your retries in a counter called Stamina Retries Total, along with the name of the failing callable and the name of the exception class. This can be a very useful signal for monitoring if one or more systems suddenly generate a lot of retries. That's a sign that something is off and you should investigate. So I hope these two lenses give you enough insight into your systems, but if not, you can implement your own. It's just a function that gets an argument that contains the retry details. And of course, if you prefer flying blind for extra adrenaline in your life, one line of code and instrumentation is completely off. And I think that's all there is to know about Stamina. So I hope I've sensitized you about both the importance and the dangers of retries. And if you're writing Python, maybe inspired you to try out my little stamina thingy. I think it's pretty cool. So let me know in the comments what you think. And if all this was too fast, I encourage you to check out Stamina's documentation, even if you don't want to use it or even if you don't use Python. The docs will point you to much more helpful material that will help you to use your favorite retry solution in your favorite programming language. Also, 7 short years ago, I gave a talk called Solid Snakes or How to Take 5 Weeks of Vacation. That is about all the things I just talked about and many other adjacent topics. So if you care about reliable systems at all, check it out. It aged better than I did. Wow. Video number 6 in the books. Thank you for sticking with me. Nowadays, most users come from the algorithm, which makes me super excited since I get the chance to speak completely new people, which was the original reason for me to start this channel. So welcome to the Hynek Cinematic Universe if you haven't heard of me before. And thank you to my existing fans and sponsors. Without you, I would never have been able to bootstrap this channel to more than 2,000 subscribers within a year with only 5 videos because I overthink everything. Of course, due to its absolutely perfect timing, the last video was a wild success with more views than the rest of my videos combined, which gives me a bit of writer's block because it's clear that I won't be able to replicate that kind of success anytime soon. Unless I listen to the siren's call of CEO and serve zeitgeist topics everyone is searching for, which is something I emphatically do not want to do. But I also don't want to produce content nobody cares about. So let me know what y'all think. You know where the comments are. I think I will aim for some kind of balance and that's it, but we will see. So thanks to everyone who watches all the way to the end. You are the best. See you hopefully soon.